Our God is a God who does new things in our lives. We need a new attitude and a new character to receive, develop, and grow what He is releasing. The new wine, which is His fresh revelation and anointing, requires us to be new wineskins. In this sermon, we consider aspects that can help us become new wineskins.
Once again, it's a privilege to be here and to share God's word. I hope all of you have had a good Christmas. Yes? How many of you enjoyed Christmas? Okay, praise God. Everyone's had a wonderful Christmas, spent time with family and friends. New Year's coming up. Right? So tomorrow we'll be here for the New Year's service. And how many of us are excited about the New Year? Anyone here not excited about the new year? Okay, absolutely nobody. So that's wonderful. And as we were singing this morning and praising God, you know, we said, God, you are so good and you are perfect in all your ways. So as we look ahead to the new year, one thing that we can be sure of is that God has good plans for us. Amen? He's a God who always leads us from strength to strength and glory to glory. How many of us agree with that? Amen. Praise God. So we are very excited about what God has in store for us. And we know that we serve a God who is perfect. Everything that comes from Him is good and it is perfect. It's us and our hearts that need to be ready to receive the perfect gift that God is releasing into our hearts and into our lives. So we must understand that God will release His best to us, but the preparation of our hearts is our responsibility. So this morning, I'm here to share with us from the Word of God as to how you and I can be prepared to receive what the Lord is pouring out into our lives, and especially for the coming year, 2019. Okay, so please fasten your seatbelts, and I really hope to unfold a couple of things here as to how we can embark on this process and be ready for what God is doing in our midst. Please turn in your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 5, verses 36 to 39. So this is a passage when the disciples of John the Baptist approach Jesus and they put across a question about fasting. Okay, Jesus says these words as a response to that question. So Luke chapter 5 verses 36 to 39. Then He spoke a parable to them. No one puts a piece from a new garment on an old one. Otherwise, the new makes a tear. And also the piece that was taken out of the new does not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, or else the new wine will burst the wineskins and be spilled, and the wineskins will be ruined. But new wine must be put into new wineskins, and both are preserved. And no one, having drunk old wine, immediately desires new, for he says the old is better. So we find here that Jesus is talking about putting a new piece of unshrunk cloth on an old cloth to repair it, right? And he talks about how this would tear the, whatever you're trying to do would really not materialize, because, you know, both of them would cause a greater tear. Okay, and Jesus is also talking about how new wine can only be poured into new wineskins. Now, wineskins are containers that people used during Jesus' times. They were made of animal skin, and they would store new wine in them for a prolonged period of time. And how this would help is that as this new wine ferments, and the process progresses, the new wine, because of its flexibility, would allow this process to continue to fulfillment, right? However, if people were to put new wine in old wineskins, now Jesus, you know, talks about that as well. He says, if you put new wine in old wineskin, then what's going to happen? It's going to burst. It will spill over. So we will not serve the purpose. And it's a bad idea to put new wine in old wineskins. As new wine is poured out, there is a requirement for a new wineskin which would receive this new wine. Okay, so first let's just try to understand what Jesus was trying to point here. Because the disciples of John the Baptist asked him a question about fasting, and this is what Jesus has to tell them. So basically what Jesus was saying is that his teaching is the new wine. Now people of his times already had the Judaic law. And what Jesus is saying is that in contrast to the rigid Judaic laws, his teaching is the new wine that is being poured out in those times. What the Pharisees taught at that time was very different from what Jesus was teaching. And in fact, many people could not even receive what he was teaching because their hearts were not the new wineskin prepared to receive the wisdom, the power, the knowledge, the authority of the new wine that Jesus was releasing or Jesus was teaching. So Jesus, in those times, right, he taught differently from the other teachers. While others were teaching about law and about ritualism, here's Jesus talking about a personal relationship with God. Here's Jesus talking about an authentic spiritual life and authentic encounters that we can have with the God of the universe. And the mindsets of the people of those days could not accommodate this new wine or the new teaching, the revelation that Jesus was bringing forth. Jesus also taught the principles of the kingdom of God. Jesus taught about the nature of the kingdom of God, something that people had never, ever heard before. And Jesus was not only saying these things and teaching about the kingdom, but he was also demonstrating the kingdom. So we understand that Jesus released the new wine or the new teaching in his times. But God is a God who has this personality. He is the Almighty God who is greater than everything we know. And he's also a God who does new things as part of who he is. That's so part of his nature. Our God is a God who brings forth new things. He speaks a new word into our hearts. Now, I'm not saying that this means, we forget and, that some absolutely new doctrine is what God is going to release. No, that's not what I'm saying, because we always uphold the standard of God's word. The revelation that God brings is progressive. The Lord builds line upon line and precept upon precept. So we hold on to the standard of God's word. We hold on to the revelation that has been brought into our lives thus far, but we also receive the new revelation that God is bringing into our hearts. So God speaks a new word into our hearts. You know, sometimes we've read those scriptures, we've meditated on those scriptures, and you still, you don't seem to see much in them, but one day the lights come on, right? So the tube light comes on, so to speak. And You're seeing things there that you never, ever saw before. And our God is in the business of releasing new things into our hearts and into our lives. Our God does new things. You know, when we become children of God, when we accept Jesus and what he has done on the cross of Calvary, the Bible says he makes us a new creation. Have you ever thought about that? You know, God does not choose to just remodel, rebuild, recycle us, but God makes us a brand new creation. And he gives that new creation being on the inside of us the power and the authority, you know, that is unlike anything else. And so God makes us a new creation in him. God is also a God who speaks of a new anointing. You know, Psalm 92:10, it says, God, that he will pour out a fresh anointing on us. So, you know, it's okay to have wonderful things in our lives that God has done. We are so grateful, right? We're so grateful for the ways in which he has strengthened us and the ways in which he's led us. But God is interested in pouring out a fresh anointing for tomorrow. God is interested in pouring out a new anointing on us for the glory of his name. And he is a God who says, behold, I make everything new. I make everything new. And only he has the ability to do that. But church, can we desire this new thing that the Lord wants to release in our midst and release into our hearts? You know, once in a while, even vehicles need a change of oil. Okay, they need change of parts, carburetor, whatever else, different parts, right? The mirror, they all need to be changed at some point or the other. And, you know, sometimes we decide to change the entire vehicle, right? Because it is more effective to have something in working condition, something new and effective. And we are a generation who understands upgrade like no one else, right? So Apple comes up every few years with a new iPhone. Though, okay, yeah, so, you know, people are already updated. And if we're not following the upgrade of the instrument, the apps are getting upgraded every few weeks or months, I don't know. But, you know, everything is getting upgraded. And when things around us require a change, how much more? No, we need a change and a refreshing in the presence of God and to receive the new thing that the Lord is releasing into our midst and into our hearts. I just want to go back to the same passage of Luke chapter 5 and look at verse 39, because it's very interesting. Jesus says, "And no one, having drunk old wine, immediately desires new, for he says, the old is better." Embracing the new, right, is not so easy. And Jesus is pointing out here that those who have drunk the old wine sometimes are unable to accept the new easily. And change is not easy. Accepting the new thing, embracing the new thing that God is doing is never easy. And why is it so? You know, as people, you know, we find it difficult to change our set ways of thinking. We find it difficult to change our set ways of doing things. We're so comfortable, you know, when the Israelites, I'm sure, as the Lord was leading them through different places to the promised land, wherever they found a comfortable spot, they would have put a camp there and said, hey, I'm not coming. Like, this is really, really comfortable. There's quail, there's manna, there's everything I need. So please, Moses, don't ask us to move from here. No, we are people who prefer to camp in a comfortable zone. And that's part of our nature. But we've got to embrace the change. We've got to receive the new work of God that He is releasing into our hearts. People also could be very familiar with the past ways, you know, and it's difficult to change from the familiar. Like, even if you have a brand new vehicle that's running really well, but there are some of those memories. Oh, my horn used to sound like that previous car, you know, stuff like that, because we find familiar, we're comfortable with what is familiar. And as people, you know, we want to resist change. The way Jesus said, people who drank the new wine, they said the old was better. But we cannot remain in that condition and still expect to receive the new that God is doing. When God is calling us ahead, we need the grace of God to move forward. Yes, yesterday was wonderful. We've seen God do great and wonderful things in our lives. We've seen God do mighty things in the ministry. We've seen God do great things in our family. God's set us free in our personal lives in so many areas. We've come up higher, and we praise God for all of that. But God wants to do much more. He wants to release much more into our lives, and He's calling us forward. While we reminisce God's awesomeness, yes, in our yesterdays, no, let us also be excited about what God is going to do tomorrow. God is indeed releasing new things into our being, new things, new purposes into our lives, that He may be glorified. He is a God who renews us. He wants to renew us, and He wants to keep leading us forward. Now, I began by saying that preparation is our responsibility. While God wants to release the new, you know, the new word, the new revelation, the new work, new purpose, a new anointing on our lives, we are the ones who have to present ourselves as a ready vessel for what the Lord is pouring out. So the new wine requires new wineskin. And this morning, this is what I wanted to share with us, that we as God's people in every season of our lives need to come before Him and ask Him, Father, prepare me to be that new wineskin, because I want to receive what You are pouring out into my life. God is perfect, His gift is perfect, and He will release His good and perfect gift, which is the new wine. But if the wineskin is old, it will not have the capacity to hold what Almighty God is releasing. And so we ought to be in a process of preparation. Our hearts need to prepare for what the Lord would want to release into our hearts and into our lives. So the new wineskin is the readiness of our hearts. Right? So this morning, can we just take a moment, church, and think to ourselves, am I ready? Am I prepared to receive all that God has in store for me for the coming season, or, you know, the next year, 2019? What is it going to take to prepare my heart for what God wants to release? The new wineskin is our readiness. And the new wineskin is also a new attitude of our hearts. It's a place of, you know, coming up higher in our character. Unless the wineskin is prepared in this manner, it will not be able to receive, hold, develop, and, you know, because God is releasing His glory into our lives, and we are called to release it back to bless others and to bless the world. We will not be in a position to receive and release the new thing that God is doing in our midst. So this morning, church, I want to share with us some points to help us prepare ourselves as the new wineskin. So I'm going to share 7 points with us that will help us become that new wineskin and be ready before the Lord. So the first point to become that new wineskin is intimacy with God. In John chapter 15, verse 5, Jesus says, without me, you can do nothing. What can we do of ourselves? Absolutely nothing. It's only in God, intimacy with the Lord, that we can live this life of purpose. You know, that God is leading us in. We can try to do things on our own, but those would be the works of the flesh. The first and foremost thing for us to prepare ourselves as the new wineskin is to offer ourselves completely to the Lord and be intimate with the Lord. Now you may ask me, what does it mean to be intimate with God? You know, we receive Christ and we become His children, but we've got to come to a place in the Lord where we are spending time with Him, where we know His word, we honor His word, we honor the work of the Spirit in our lives, and where we give Him priority. Now, this morning we sang that song about trust and obey, and one of the lines says, till all on the altar we lay, right? So it's a place of coming close to God, coming to a place of surrender where we say, God, I am yours. All of me is yours, O God. And so I want to spend time with you. I want to get to know you more, which is why I want to read my Bible. I want to pray. And I just want to grow in you, O God. And without that, yes, God will pour out the new anointing. He is faithful. But are our hearts in that place where we are desirous of this kind of intimacy with the Lord? And where we come to a place of saying, God, do a new thing in my life. Do a fresh thing, oh God, in my life. I'm ready to receive what you have in store for me. No, beyond the Christian activity. I know I'm speaking to many of us. We could be serving, we could be doing several things for God, and that's wonderful. But even beyond all of that, can we come to a place where we say, God, I'm doing it for you. God, I want this authentic encounter with you. And which is why I'm engaging in all these things. Not because, you know, they're good things to do and we have to do them. No, not at all. But coming to a place of such intimacy and hunger for the Lord. Isaiah chapter 44. Isaiah 44 verses 3 and 4 where scriptures talk about how we hunger after the Lord. The Lord pours out water on him who is thirsty. How thirsty are we? How hungry are we? And the Lord can only release in greater measure when we are waiting, when we are seeking, when we are looking, and we are wanting for him to pour out his presence, pour out himself, pour out his glory. And so intimacy with God and hunger for God is something that will prepare us as the new wineskin. Even as we just look back at history, it took people, simple people, who said, God, I give all of me to you. God, I want to hunger after you. Right, these were all, very, very simple people. We read about the Moravian revival. Why? Because a set of people decided to pray 24 hours. Just a bunch of normal people who believed in God. And as they prayed, the prayer kept going for 100 years, and God did mighty things. A revival came through because of a set of people who prioritized the presence of God, who were hungry for God. There are other individuals as well. Now, Evan Roberts of the Welsh Revival, a man who prayed all the time. Sometimes, you know, people looked at him and they, you know, he would pray as he walked, and some people thought he was mad. Right, so he prayed that much. You can pray, you know, however you prefer. I'm just saying that's how he prayed. And of course, there's William J. Seymour who spent hours and hours of time in prayer. And what was the result of all this? As people prioritized God, time with God, more of His presence, as they hungered and desired for more of God, we've seen mighty moves of the Spirit just, you know, sweep across cities, across states, across nations. And God can only pour out on the thirsty. And so the first and foremost preparation of our hearts is intimacy with the Lord. And a place of hungering, you know, more after the Lord. The second important preparation of our hearts is to yield to this new anointing that the Lord is pouring out on us. Now, when the Lord does a new thing in our midst, we are used to our familiar ways, and it's hard to break out of that and to say, yes, okay, God, you can do this. Right? A classic example of someone who encountered a new anointing is Saul. You know, Saul, in 1 Samuel chapter 10, when he bumped into a group of prophets, he had the anointing of a leader, but you know, he began to prophesy. A leader who prophesied. The new anointing, the prophetic anointing, influenced Saul, who was given the primary assignment of a leader. And as God releases a new anointing upon us, we may find that we are being moved into new arenas. God's giving us new ideas, new desires, new strategies, and opening up doors for us and empowering us to do that. Right? We may find that we are moving in that anointing. But as we see God pour out this anointing, one of the things that we have to keep in our minds is we've got to allow God to do it. When we see that God is releasing us in that direction, we've got to say, Holy Spirit, I yield to what you're doing. This new desire, God, this new hunger of praying, you know, a few more hours a day, God, I'm going to yield to this. Or we're flowing in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We may have a hesitation and say, okay, I don't think I can move with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But as the Lord is releasing these things upon us, we've got to yield to Him and say, yes, Lord, I know you are doing this. So God, I want more of what you're doing in my life. I receive it. Some of us may find that God is leading us to minister in certain ways, right? You were teaching a small group of people. Now, God may be wanting for you to teach more people. And you're thinking, God, how am I going to do this? Trust God. As the Lord releases that new anointing, you would find that God also gives that boldness which is required. He empowers us to do what He calls us to do. Amen? So the second point is that we must yield to the new anointing, the leading of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And we know that it's only because of our dependence on Him that we begin the journey, we walk through, we continue in the journey, and we will reach the end of the journey because of our dependence on Him and His power in our lives. The third preparation to receive the new that God is pouring out into our lives is to accommodate the positive change that God is bringing. Now, as the Lord releases new things into our hearts, new desires, you know, to maybe move in the gifts of the Spirit. Now, how many of us know that faith is spelt R-I-S-K, risk, okay? God is releasing a new thing, but we are not sure. What if I say something wrong, no? Or share the gospel with someone? What if my colleague thinks I'm crazy? We do not want to step out. But as the Lord releases the new thing into our hearts and into our lives, and we've got to be a people who move and say, God, I'm willing to accommodate. Now, as the Lord pours out an anointing to maybe teach, right? We are willing to make the changes that are required in our own schedules, in our lifestyle, and say, God, okay, more time for you, more time for study. Or the God, if God may be encouraging our hearts to spend more time in intercession, our schedule changes, right? We give more time. We prioritize the thing that God is emphasizing to us. And so we accommodate what the Lord is doing. By faith, we take those steps forward and say, God, I'm doing it. I know you will come through. I know people will be blessed. Amen? And so as the Lord prompts to different ones of us that this is the new thing I'm doing in your life, we've got to be a people who say, God, yes, I will accommodate it in my plan, into my schedule. And whenever God does a new thing, it also stretches us. No, it makes us uncomfortable. But we know that God is good and he's doing a good thing in our lives. And therefore, we receive what the Lord is doing and we are willing to be stretched. We are willing to pay the price. No, if God is prompting us in our hearts, you know, you need to pray some more. We may put the alarm for like really early in the morning, whatever, 4 o'clock, and we're feeling stretched. Oh no, you know, my sleep time is gone. I need some extra rest. But hey, we're saying, God, it's okay. I'm willing to be stretched. I'm willing to pay the price. Everything that God wants for us to do is going to require our agreement. And there may be things that we are happy with that we may have to put aside and say, okay, fine, you know, I'm willing to let go. I'm willing to come early. I'm willing to pray with somebody. I'm willing to share the word of God with somebody. I'm willing to share the gospel with someone, right? I'm willing to pray for the sick. And we come to a place where we say, God, what you are doing in my life is really exciting. And that's what I want. So I'm going to accommodate what you are doing in my life. The fourth one is to be the new wineskin. We've got to have our minds renewed with the word of God. We've got to have our minds renewed and just the way we made our declaration this morning. You know, we agreed with God's word. We're not conformed to the ways of this world, but we are transformed by the word of God. And we say, yes, God, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, I am one with Christ. Through Christ, I am an overcomer. The Lord will grant me wisdom. He will give me the required revelation. And I'm able to do what God is calling me to do. And so we agree with God's word and we are renewed in our thinking. And it's very important for us to have a renewed mind when the Lord is speaking to us. You know, even when Jesus was preaching and teaching, people could not accept what he was doing because of their old mindsets. So as children of God, we spend time in his word. We honor his word. We are renewed in our minds, and that's when we become that new wineskin that is able to hold the new thing that the Lord is doing. The fifth point is to pursue purity. Now, God always releases what is pure and perfect. It's about the vessel which will receive what the Lord is doing. And so Paul writes to Timothy, he says, you know, be a vessel of honor. And as we come before the Lord to receive the new work that he will do in our lives, we need to put aside everything that doesn't bring God glory, that doesn't bring God honor. No, the works of the flesh, things that are wrong in the sight of God. Some of us may say, okay, none of that, you know, I'm not associated with any of that. But what about self? What about pride? As we receive what the Lord is doing, we come before him and we say, God, I come to you as a vessel of honor. Prepare me, O God, as a vessel of honor, because I want to receive this pure gift that you are pouring into my heart and into my life. And it's very important for us to come before God as a new wineskin that has set aside all sin and evil in the sight of God. Now, we can't be off the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. So we come before God with everything that concerns us in our personal lives. Are there things that we are holding on to that we're very clear the Holy Spirit is convicting us about? And we've got to let go. You know, God cannot pour out the pure into the impure. Many people say, you know, we're doing the right stuff. We are praying, we are worshiping. You know, Pastor, don't ask about other things. What about our entertainment, right? What kind of entertainment do we go for? These are questions that we ask ourselves because, you know, we want to receive the wonderful, pure gift, the new anointing that the Lord is pouring out. So we check our own hearts and our lives and say, God, whatever it is that is displeasing to you, you know, I am willing to get rid of that from my life, and I offer myself to you as a vessel of honor. We check our family lives, our work life, and see, God, is there anything, absolutely anything, which does not give you glory? And we are willing to, you know, get rid of all of that so that we can be a vessel of honor to receive what the Lord is pouring out into our lives. And point six is to come with an attitude of meekness. James 1 verse 21, you know, it encourages us to receive the implanted word of God with meekness. Or meekness is an attitude which says, God, I come humbly before you and I receive what you are saying. I am teachable before you, O God. Lord, I will hold on to your standards, and I'm also open to the new way in which you are doing things and will do things in my life, in my community, in my family. And God, I'm willing to receive. If it is you speaking, I'm willing to receive from anywhere, anyone. God, I just got to know that it's you. And I come before you, Lord, humbling myself and saying, God, I treasure your word. I treasure your instruction. I treasure your directive. So a heart that is teachable is important as we prepare ourselves to be the new wineskin. Now, what if God were to do things in a very different way, in the methods, the strategy of doing ministry and the way we do church, right? We come before God and say, okay, God, this is what you are doing. And we will move, God. It's a little uncomfortable. My schedule is changing. You know, my sleep time is not enough. But it's okay, God. I just want to get on this plan of yours. And I want to see your glory revealed in my church, in my city, and in my nation. So we come before God with a heart of meekness to receive what the Lord is releasing. And the seventh point, and everybody say hallelujah. It's already reached seventh point. Commitment to growth. New wineskin is committed to growth. Now, why does God want us to be new wineskin? Because growth is coming. And God doesn't intend for us to always remain a baby and a child. But God wants us to grow up in Him. Come to a place where we can serve, where we can walk with the Father the way Jesus did. And we can demonstrate to the world this Jesus, His glory and His power. God wants us to grow up in Him and rise up to higher levels. So point seven for us to become the new wineskin is to have this heart to say, God, I'm committed to growth. And I'm going to do stuff differently. You know, I'm going to prioritize certain things that you're asking me to prioritize. And I'm going to commit to these things, oh God, because I know that if I commit myself to what, you know, God is pointing out, maybe some of us here, you know, God may, you may have a wonderful voice and you've never really wanted to sing for God. But in the coming year, God would be speaking to you and saying, I want you to sing for me. So can you commit to whatever it is the Lord is doing, and also to grow, to nurture and develop that skill for the glory of God? To grow in our spiritual life. Yes, praise God for what we know in Him. But God, I want to know more. What can I do to learn more, to come closer to you? So we are committing to growth. We're making the changes and accommodating the instructions of God so that we can see exponential growth in the season ahead of us. And so this morning, church, are we the new wineskin yet? Or are we in a place where we're saying, God, I want to be that new wineskin because I know that you are a God who does a new thing in my life. And I want to be in a place, oh God, to receive that new thing that you are doing. God, examine my heart, and if there is anything that I need to surrender so I can be, more intimate with you, then God, give me the grace to do it. I give in to that, oh God. I yield to the work of the Holy Spirit. God, I am willing to renew my mind. I'm willing to spend time in your word, oh God. God, speak to me. Prepare me to be that new wineskin. God, I will pursue purity. And God, I will uphold your standards of holiness. Lord, help me, O God, to be ready to receive your good and perfect gift, your pure gift that you're pouring out into my life. Enable me, O God, to commit myself to growth. I can't be the same person at the same level that I'm at right now. I have to grow in you. And so, God, release this new anointing, this new revelation, this new work of your Spirit into my heart, Lord, into my life. The church, can we have this heart of a new wineskin and say, God, we are ready. Lord, we are ready to receive what you're doing. I request us to please rise to our feet, and I'll also call upon the worship team. We'll spend some time responding to the Lord, receiving the word that He's ministering to us this morning, worshiping Him. I request Anand to lead us in a song of worship, and we'll come back and pray after that.
Purify my heart, let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart, let me be as gold, pure gold. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, refine as fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will.
Define us by.
Presence of God this morning. The new year will dawn on us very soon. And as the Lord would release new things into our lives as individuals, in a community, let's offer ourselves as new wineskins before the Lord. And I'm just gonna say a prayer, and I request all of us to just repeat after me. A prayer to dedicate ourselves and consecrate ourselves to God. Dear Lord Jesus, I pray in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you will open my heart to the new thing that you are releasing into my life. Father, I thank you that you are a God who releases new wine and a fresh anointing. Father, renew me and cause me, O God, to become the new wineskin, because I want to receive everything that you have in store for me. This morning, God, I pray that you will cleanse me even from my familiar ways, God. Lord, I commit myself to holiness and purity, and I yield to the work of the Holy Spirit in me, in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we praise you for doing a new thing, God, in our hearts this morning. And at this time, I just want to speak to those of us here in the congregation. You're probably not, you don't understand what I'm speaking about, and you don't know this Jesus that we worship here as your God and your Savior. And I just want to speak to you for a moment and let you know that God sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, as a perfect sacrifice, who died on the cross for the sins of the world, for my sins, for your sins, that they can be forgiven. And God is a God who loves you and wants you back in a relationship with him. And if you choose this moment to receive the Lord Jesus, God is a God who makes those who receive him his children in that very moment. Not only will he forgive all our sins, but he will also release all the other blessings of heaven and the cross into our lives. So I want to invite those who've never received the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior, and this morning you're saying, I want this Jesus, I want this God in my life. I don't want to step into 2019 without knowing Jesus. And I want to invite you to make this great decision of your life, of accepting Jesus into your heart and into your life. And I'm going to pray a small prayer, and I encourage those who want to receive this Jesus to just repeat after me. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. I acknowledge that you're a Son of God, and I receive you, O God, into my heart, into my life. Thank you that I've become a child of God today, and God, the power of sin has been broken over my life. I give you thanks. I give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. If there's anyone, you've prayed that prayer today, and we're really excited for you. We want to celebrate with you. I encourage you to please put up your hands so we know where you are. We have a gift packet that we want to give to you. And is there anyone, you've prayed that prayer this morning? Could you just indicate by putting up your hand? All right, so if you've prayed that prayer, then, you know, do let us know. You could probably just come forward after the service, because we have a gift packet to give to you and a decision card which you can fill in, and we'll be in touch with you to help you on this journey of walking with Jesus. We'll just take a few more minutes to pray for the rest of us and close this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your wonderful presence in our lives through the year, Lord, 2018. And Father, this morning, we ask, oh God, for you to minister to every heart and every life in this place. God, even as we've dedicated ourselves to you, God, Father, we thank you for the chains that bound us, Father, have been broken. Father, we praise you for those who have been freed from the grip of addictions in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the hope that is filling our hearts. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, those of us, Father, who have sort of felt that we are in darkness with Lord, absolutely nothing to look forward to in the coming year. Lord, we thank you for your hope that is just filling and flooding hearts of people in this place, oh God. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the pictures, the visions, oh God, that you're releasing right now into people's hearts. Lord, those who did not have a plan, I praise you that right now, God, you are releasing those ideas into their hearts in the name of Jesus. We thank you that you are the good shepherd, Lord, who will lead us forward. And right now, church, I want us to believe if anyone is going through sickness and disease of any sort, to just believe God for healing. And say, God, you died on that cross 2,000 years ago, and by your stripes, I was healed. And God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I release that healing. Father, I thank you for new strength, Lord. I thank you, God, for the body parts that are functioning, that were not functioning a moment ago. I just sense that the Lord be touching our feet and legs of people. You know, if you were not able to move your leg and you're able to, you can just check it now. You can try and move it and see if there is a change. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Anyone here, you noticed a change, an immediate change? Could you just indicate to us so we can celebrate that? No problem. If you want to, you know, take time, check, and then let us know, that's all right as well. And Father, we just want to praise you and thank you, God, for all that you are doing in our midst, Father God. And Lord, we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Man, God bless you, church. And I just want to, you know, speak the word of benediction upon us as we close this morning. May the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of the Father, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forever. And everyone said, Amen. Amen.
We trust that this message was a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. You can email us at contact@apcwo.org. Also visit our website apcwo.org for additional resources. Thank you for listening, and God bless you.